The catalyst for this trip came from an interview I read, where a man was describing a trip he had recently made to Antarctica aboard an old tall ship called the Europa. He said that it was the most difficult and rewarding thing he's ever done. He added, "There were six guys to a room with one toilet, pretty grim odds." I thought to myself, why is it always guys? I want to do that. I booked my trip to the southernmost city in Argentina. Once I arrived in Ushuaia, I made my way to the harbor, past the luxury cruise ship, and found the 100-year-old bark Europa, which would make me work for my arrival in Antarctica. I was surprised to find that there were a few of us individual female travelers on board. After the orientation, we were split into teams and were given shifts to be on lookout and at the helm. Besides having to live on a ship for 23 days and not knowing how my body would handle the motion and the proximity to 50 other people, I also had to give up the modern comforts of the internet and cell reception. I ended up finding a freedom in the automatic electronic reply, "Gone to Antarctica." Today was our first day at sea. We set sail at 6 a.m. and made it through the Beagle Channel. And now we're off into the Drake Passage. We are on watch shifts of 4 hours, so right now it's 4 a.m, and I just finished my midnight to 4 a.m. shift. We had some big swells today. We lost about 6 of our crew members to seasickness. I guess if there's that many people sick, we might not see them until we get through the Drake Passage when it calms down. But for the most part, spirits are pretty high and everyone seems really excited. I'm feeling pretty nauseous, but not so bad. Just stay active and pull on ropes and stare at the horizon. The unimpeded waves of the Southern Ocean squeeze through the narrow and shallow bottleneck of the Drake Passage, and in the process, generate complicated, unpredictable, and often brutal weather. The Antarctic circumpolar current is considered the mightiest current in the oceans. It carries a huge volume of water and flows at the equivalent of 5,000 Amazon rivers. Okay, so it's day two, and I slept very well last night after the dog watch, had a very nutritious lunch, did some little bit of calisthenics on the boat with some of my co-sailors, and then actually climbed to the top part of the sailboat, which was 5 sails high, and that was very frightening and difficult, and especially because we're in the open ocean and there was a lot of back and forth. Overall, I feel pretty healthy. My appetite's been good. I've been able to read a little bit. And today was the first day I felt the withdrawal of using internet. Can't drink too much when you're on these duties, but we finish at midnight tonight, so we're gonna have a beer before going to bed. And then we start again at 8 a.m. tomorrow. So we're always revolving our shifts so that we see different times of day and night. It's kind of day 2 to 3 right now, so it's difficult to think that it's going to be another, 19 or 20 days on this boat, but I'm sure it'll make sense as we go.
Very early in the morning on day 5, we spotted land. The South Shetland Islands would be the place to stretch our legs and have our first penguin sighting and smelling. Zodiac boats would take us onto the volcanic shores of Deception Island, where we went for a long hike to explore the large chinstrap penguin colony. We are now at 63 degrees south. The temperature has dropped to 3 degrees Celsius as we take a Zodiac cruise through the narrow passage between Trinity and Spurt Islands. If I've been questioning myself as to why I would go on a holiday to see ice, the shocking beauty of the icebergs now shut me up completely. After 4 days in the Drake Passage, then several landings in the South Shetland Islands, it is now day 12 and we arrived on the continent. In Nico Harbor, our guide warns that if any chunks of the glacier should come off while we are ashore, we should follow the penguins up the slopes to avoid getting washed away by the waves. The sun came out later that afternoon and one of our voyage crew decided to practice a man overboard drill. We had a party aboard the ship one night, where we all got to know each other's wild side. After 23 days living together in 53 meters of boat, there were still some surprises left. We've reached our southernmost latitude on our trip, 65 degrees 22 minutes south. This is the Trues Glacier, with its ice wall measuring 60 to 70 meters straight up from the water level, and the mother of most of the icebergs present here in Collins Bay. I've never been happier just sitting on the deck for hours watching the ice. We had achieved both physical and psychological distance from civilization, and the results were euphoric. So this is our last landing before leaving Antarctica. I think it's on day 18 or so, and we're anticipating a 5-day Drake Passage. I'm hoping for a storm, and we're about to go climb another glacier. There's a whale behind me and the ship. After saying our goodbyes to the continent, we sail along the side of a huge tabular iceberg, which our crew measures at 55 meters high. Before reading that interview, I had never thought about going to Antarctica. But once I arrived there, I realized that I had always dreamed of going. I took this trip on as a challenge. I was nervous and not sure what to expect. But it was easier than I thought it would be. It was an experience that would stay with me in a more profound way than I had ever expected. Now safely back on shore in South America, I thought it would be the perfect time to visit the Amazon.
15 years I've dreamed of this moment. 15 years. Every night. Every night, there's always music. Music of violins.
So I've just arrived last night in the northern city of Belém. It's the gateway to the Amazon. There's this big local food market. There's local fish fried. Awesome. I hope I don't get diarrhea because tomorrow we're going on to an adventure into the Amazon. So this is officially my first time on the Amazon River, just still outside of Belém. So I can still literally see the city behind me as we enter into this smaller river pathway. So a new thing I discovered is that, like this coconut thing, he cracked it open and this is actually where the Brazil nuts come from.
Vai lá.
Tá. This man is in his 80s, and he climbs these trees to collect acai berries, which are considered to be a superfruit and full of antioxidants.
Keep going.
Okay. Thank you. Today is not my day. I was checking out of my hostel and taking the bus to the airport to catch a flight to Santarém, which is further inside the Amazon. And I got on the bus and paid. And when I went to put the change away in my little change purse that has extra money and one of my credit cards in it, I couldn't find it. And when I tried to find my phone to call the hostel and see if I left it there, I couldn't find my phone either, so maybe someone nicked it out of my bag. Even now, I have my camera out on the bus, and maybe not the smartest thing, but I wanted to make sure I was documenting, you know, the frustrating times as well. So my stomach's sore today and yesterday, and so I was just not in the mood for this to happen, but, you know, it happens. It's part of traveling. The water is so warm and I just stuck my hand in it, and our guide said, don't do that because the piranhas can bite you. So I guess we're not swimming here. Now we're rowing through the little water forest. It's beautiful. We're trying to find water lilies right now. We seem to be a little bit stuck, but we're pushing back. They're the big green water lilies. He sees them, but we just can't quite get to them. After our long journey through the river, we have our fresh river fish. What's it called?
Tabaqui.
We're in this place that looks almost like Thailand or something. It definitely looks like we're on an ocean somewhere, but it's actually just a river. This morning to Santarém to catch my boat to Manaus. The boat was 130 real, which is about 50 American dollars. So I had to buy this hammock for 40 real. Now we're on here for 3 days. I've met an Australian
by herself, so I've partnered up with her to watch each other's bags, watch each other's backs. I'm super sweaty from carrying our stuff all around, and we had to go to the market to buy some food and vegetables which were hanging above us.
She had put her her money attached to her suitcase, which was locked. And when she woke up in the morning, she found that they tore open the zipper and went in and just took the cash out. We'll just do our best to try and relay that information in Portuguese to the captain or whomever on the boat. And I'm sure it won't make a big difference, but at least they know that, you know, it is happening. I don't think I could have dealt with another robbery. It would have been upsetting.
So day two, this is our lunch. I got the meat this time. It's feeling a bit strung out. So my Australian friend and I got some of the cachaça drink for lunch, and we're sitting up here on the top deck pretty peacefully by ourselves, except the stares that we're getting constantly on this boat. But the view is nice, and we're in the Amazon and about to have a drink at lunch, so nice little vacation. From Manaus, it was a 3-hour bus trip and then transferred to a small little speedboat, and then we went downriver for 1 hour and arrived at this beautiful jungle lodge. So this afternoon we're going to be looking for dolphins, and we're going to be doing some piranha fishing. We're paddling through a flooded forest right now, and the smells are just incredible, like this sweet tree smell. Careful. This is raw chicken meat. This is a stick. I got a piranha.
Oh, be careful. Don't
bite me.
Yeah.
He's so little, but his teeth are strong already.
I'm about to leave the lodge and the river and head into the jungle for 3 nights with my guide. So I've got my hammock packed, mosquito spray, suntan lotion. Leaving the river behind, going that way into the forest to start our 3-day. Is it sharp?
Yeah, of course.
Don't fall on it.
Yeah.
Okay, let's go. We've arrived at the camp for our first night, soaked in sweat. But there's a stream nearby, so that's where I can have my shower, and there's a fire pit ready for us. And we have a bit of a shelter for our hammocks. Dinner is served. This is the spoon. This is the plate. Chicken in Portuguese is frango. The language has been challenging, but obrigado means thank you.
Yeah.
We've picked up a secondary guide just in case someone sprains an ankle or dies. So now we're traveling by boat to a different location and
walking 4 hours into the jungle. I have my own supply of food and water, and the guides are carrying their own stuff as well.
So this is our next location on the river, and we're starting at this house.
I'm soaked with sweat again, of course. My pack feels heavy as we move to our second camp. I'm trying to be quiet so I don't startle away any monkeys. We restocked on water, so it's extra heavy. I have 4 liters on me right now, and a pineapple. Making pretty good pace. We're taking a break right now because we're all pretty sweaty. Here's our new camp for tonight. Oof, I'm very tired. It's been a really long day. It was 2.5 hours from the very first camp, and with our packs on, and then to the water, boat ride to that house, and then a 4 hour walk to here, and the sun is starting to set, so it looks like we're just gonna have dinner and hang out here. So this is my view. My brain can't work right now. We'll probably have chicken for dinner again. I'm not sure what we'll eat tomorrow. It's nice to get that pineapple off my back. And this is where I get to brush my teeth, wash my face, and try to put in my contact lenses. Joseph had a dream that howler monkeys were grabbing onto his arm, so he was yelling in his sleep. At one point, I thought there was a group of young girls from a nearby village yelling and laughing, and it was just some frogs. So that was strange.
They call it ushi.
Ushi.
This is the food for the monkey's food again, right?
I love the monkey diet.
The biggest tree what you have in Amazonas, maybe like 50 or 60 meters high.
Well, we got it.
Heavy, right?
We left as a party of three at about 7 or 8 hours ago from our camp, and we've returned as a party of four. One of us is going to get killed and eaten for dinner, and I hope it's not me.
Sit down. Can I see his camp? Okay.
Tarantula in our camp. Was he near your bag?
Yeah.
We made it out of the jungle, back to the river.
Survived.
We survived. Uh-oh, our boat took on water. Nearing the end of my 5 days in the Amazon jungle of Brazil, the fate of the turtle was not to be dinner, but Junior, the 17-year-old boy from a nearby village, wanted to keep him for his father because they have a garden, and his father already has 2 female turtles, and so he was very excited to catch this one because it was male, so now they can have eggs. I didn't really want to try to eat turtle meat anyways. You know, it was like going camping, and it wasn't like it was so foreign, except sometimes I'd be sitting around looking at the 2 Brazilians, looking at the jungle, listening to it, and thinking, hey, I'm in Brazil right now. Just traveling by yourself is just so rewarding. Of course, there's the loneliness of it and not having someone to, you know, make decisions with and blame when things go wrong. Full moon behind me. It's 5:30 a.m.
I'm always cranky if it's before 6, so God help us all this morning.